this second event in our arts program for 75 years of Encounters in Caux. The music that you just heard was composed by Norwegian Sveinung Nygaard, which is called Pulse. Before we start, there's just a couple of practical points. One is that you probably have already heard that this event is being recorded. So if you don't want your face to be seen on the recording, you can switch off your video. Also, to let you know that there will be an opportunity at the end of the whole program to chat with the artists, and we'll explain to you how to do this when the time comes. It will be using breakout rooms. And because we can't respond directly during a performance, as we would if we were in a theatre, you can also just leave messages or make comments in the chat so that we can monitor that. Then the last thing to say is that the whole event will be just about under an hour and a half, maybe a little bit less than that. So today, it is in two parts, the program. One part is a program of songs performed by William Leigh Knight, and the second half is an interview with writer Yara Zgheib. So, part one. William is a singer and voice teacher from the UK and has worked with so-called non-singers and been researching how to help adults reclaim the joys of singing. His program is called Trance and Transformation, Inheritance Tracks from Caux. He will explain what this means as we go along. His program begins with a song.
There'll be a new world beginning from tonight. There'll be a new world beginning from tonight. When I climb up to my saddle, gonna take him to my heart. There'll be a new world beginning from tonight. Ride across the prairie, clear across the valley, straight across the heart of every man. There'll be a right new brand of living that'll sweep like lightning fire and take away the hate in every land. There'll be a new world beginning from tonight. There'll be a new world beginning from tonight. When I climb up to my saddle, gonna take into my heart, there'll be a new world beginning from tonight.
Hello everyone. The ever-popular Cowboy Carol leads off a group of songs which I've put together under the subtitle of Inheritance Tracks from Caux. This is an expression borrowed from a popular radio programme on the BBC in which celebrities choose two songs. One they feel they've inherited from an older generation, and one they would like to pass on themselves. This first song was written by Cecil Broadhurst for a Christmas show in 1944, and after that he became closely associated with moral rearmament. He was one of many gifted composers whose music has celebrated and disseminated the messages of the organisation. The music is of all sorts, ranging from meditational, devout, to provocative and uplifting, and in many different styles. There have been pantomimes, plays with music, whole musicals, as well as single songs, many of which have been popular for community singing. I've made a personal choice, and it is inevitable that it is limited by the time available. But all have been performed at Caux at some time during these last 75 years. I've dedicated this program to the memory of Kathleen Dodds, who died earlier this year. After a short stint in teaching, Kathleen started out with MRA as a repetiteur, touring India to accompany a musical show. She soon started writing her own material. She was very much my source and inspiration for work that I've done for IofC, and I was lucky to have been accompanied by her on several occasions. Today, I'm accompanied on these recordings by my friend John Collis. St. Francis has become the patron saint of the environmental movement, and in one poem wrote, "Praised be you, Lord, through Sister Water, who is so youthful, humble, precious, and pure." Next, I shall sing Kathleen's setting of the St. Francis Prayer.
Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, may I bring love. Where there is injury, may I bring pardon. Where there is doubt, may I bring faith. Where there is despair, may I bring hope. Where there is sadness, may I bring joy. Where there is darkness, may I bring light. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be comforted as to comfort, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we may receive, in forgiving that we shall be forgiven, in dying that we are born.
While many of the moral rearmament songs have been prayerful or meditative, a lot more of them are thought-provoking and have themes of transformation or protest. The next group of songs explore some of these, starting with a song from Annie. This is not the comic strip American musical, but a musical play written some 10 years earlier in 1967. It tells the story of Annie Jaeger, a social reformer from Stockport who came and worked in London's East End. The playwright, Alan Thornhill, was an Anglican priest, and the music was by William Reed, who was a teacher, academic, as well as a composer and conductor of many of the shows. This song uses an old-fashioned, homely idea of darning to emphasize a better way of solving problems of controversy and breakdown. Annie Jaeger had been by profession a seamstress and milliner. To her, this was a natural way of life, mending things.
Are there any old hates to mend? Any old hearts to mend? Any people or races? Are there any places where there are hearts and hates to mend? In an age of smash and grab, when we're handy at giving each other the jab, somebody needs to start on a much more difficult art of mending things, mending things, a lot more rewarding than ending things. So come on out if you're looking about for someone who's mending things. Are there any old homes to mend? Any old hearts to mend? Any father or daughter don't get on as they ought to? Are there hearts and heads to mend? In a world that's running amok, where the mainspring is burst like a worn-out clock, somebody needs to start to learn the different art
of mending things. Mending things, a lot more rewarding than ending things. For a world that's at war, or a mother-in-law, we need someone who's mending things. Once on a lonely hill, they got hold of a fellow they wanted to kill. They decided to throw him out, because he went on going about. Mending things, a lot more rewarding than ending things. And people have found that he's still around, just going on mending things.
Rosa Berlino is a poet, an artist, and a member of IOC. She wrote, "This is a song for the people," and she performed it herself in Caux. Recently, she's been asked if it might be translated into Burmese. This is a song for the people. This is a song for the people without a voice. This is a voice of the people who cannot sing. This is a song never cried out by the people who cry inside. This is a song for the questions never asked, for the answers when they are questioned, for the truth when it is not blinded by the colors of the flags. This is a song for you that still believe in love, for you who are picking up the broken threads of your broken life, for the unknown hero living an unknown life. For you don't believe in boundaries of skin, religion, and sex, for all the forgotten people of all the forgotten lands. This is a song of hope for tomorrow, for a tomorrow brighter than today, for a tomorrow when the only unemployed may be soldiers. This is a song for us all, citizens of the world.
In 2014, Louis Gardner and I were part of the team organizing the Seeds of Inspiration conference at Caux. Louis, taking the idea of seeds in a literal sense, wrote this following poem about trees and nature, which we set to music together. Cath Hutchison joins me to sing Ancient Forest.
I am an ancient tree in a dense and ancient forest. I've lived long and grown through many storms and whirlwinds.
Gather round, sister trees, shelter my budding shoots. You are all I ever need to help me grow strong. My roots are deep and spreading, my trunk is strong and lithe. My branches are embracing, they reach out to you.
Gather round, brother trees, weave through your tender roots. You are all I ever need to help me belong.
We are an ancient forest. We shelter many creatures.
We share
our resources, so cherish us too. Gather round, creature friends, feed on our golden fruits. Know by taking all you need, our seeds are sown. We are an ancient forest, full of wisdom, love, and power. We learned how to mend these, to succor our world. Gather round, sister souls, dance through autumn leaves. Life is there to sell.
autumn leaves. Like this, there to celebrate, glorious and whole.
The fourth in this group is Satirical, a song of protest, which I wrote in the 90s, but which I first performed in public at Caux only in 2013. It borrows the story from the old English nursery rhyme, "There was an old woman who lived in a shoe." I entitled this version, "A Sad Song."
There was an old lady who lived in a shoe. My, my, what a hullabaloo. Her children all slept stacked up in a bunk. If the shoe'd been a ship, she'd sure have been sunk. The man from the council just tore out his hair. Such a strain on his rules, it's really not fair. The shoe was condemned without bath or a loo. Besides, who would pay for a grant on a shoe? The children were carted right off into care. The old lady did, oh, we didn't know where. Demolishers moved in to raise to the ground this decrepit old boot, which is clearly unsound. But the planners declared it a heritage site, and they slipped in an order to make it all right. And so now we're still standing, a little forlorn. Tarted up but still empty, its atmosphere shorn. A class one listed, desirable boot. Newly gentrified dwelling, a yuppie would suit.
A very different song, another one by Kathleen Dodds, combines both trance and transformation. The words are typical of her thoughtful and devout nature. From 1987, The Other Side of Silence.
One day I heard from the other side of silence. It seems like someone called my name. So clear it was from the other side of silence. My life will never be the same. The other side of silence is a path you walk alone. The other side of silence is a land of ways unknown. But it calls me and it tells me, as I tread each stepping stone, that my heart can find its home on the other side of silence. My life will never be the same. I stopped and turned, and I went towards the silence, leaving the well-worn tracks behind. I searched my heart as I stood there in the silence. I never dreamed what I would find. The other side of silence, there is nowhere you can hide. The other side of silence, there's not much room for pride.
other side of silence.
Next to me, as I play each Sunday, stands the sculpture of St. Columba, who supposedly landed on Colonsay before founding the abbey on Iona. In 1978, a group of friends conceived and put on a musical play based on the life of Columba. This great monk spread Celtic Christianity to the Hebridean Islands and beyond, famously, as the legend has it, sailing across from Ireland in the open sea on a curragh, a coracle. This is one of three links that I've made in to our festival's overarching theme of water. Here is an unaccompanied prayer based on Columba's actual words, set by Elaine Gordon, who I think is in the audience, as are Anna and Elizabeth, who are also there. This is sometimes in a lonely cell.
Sometimes in a lonely cell, in the presence of my God, I stand and listen. In the silence of my heart, I can hear him well when I listen. Despairing people flock to me. They expect that I can see the answers. They ask my advice. They say I am wise. I answer that nothing can deceive me if I stand alone and silently listen. For I am but a servant who is guided by his king when I listen. Sometimes in a lonely cell, in the presence of my God, I stand and listen. In the silence of my heart, I can hear him well when I listen.
Along with music theatre and straight plays that were put on at Caux Theatre, the Westminster Theatre in London, and many other stages, there were the annual children's pantomimes. Give a Dog a Bone by Peter Howard, with music by George Fraser, ran for many seasons. A film of the stage show is preserved in the IofC archive for a new world, and seeing it took me back nearly 60 years. If you watch it very carefully, you can spot an enthusiastic member of the audience, Cath Hutchison. Here is Somewhere, illustrated by a model of the film set by Cameron Johnson.
Somewhere just beyond tomorrow, after night and sorrow, comes the day. Somewhere the sun is rising, driving shadows all away. Never, though the road be dreary, let your heart be weary, young or old. For somewhere, somewhere there's a new day dawning, bright and gold. Somewhere just beyond tomorrow, after night and sorrow, comes the day. Somewhere the sun is rising, driving shadows all away. Always hope is to the daring, courage to the caring, so be bold. Somewhere, somewhere there's a new day dawning.
To end this small selection, I've chosen an uplifting song from the 1951 Broadway show Jotham Valley by Cecil Broadhurst. This brings us back to our general theme of water, since the underlying theme of the drama was about water rights, a subject which sadly today is of even greater importance. It also brings me round full circle. I first visited Caux in 1970 for the Christmas gathering when I was a music student. I was asked if I would lead everyone singing in the cowboy carol and then contribute this solo, Somewhere in the Heart of a Man.
The human heart accumulates, I hear, an awful lot of hate and pride and fear. It makes a fellow dumb, it makes a fellow deaf, it blinds him and it binds him right and left. But if I'm honest, I agree, an awful selfish guy like me need never let a day go by, a minute or an hour go by. A man gets tired of sinning, he could make a new beginning quicker than the flicker of an eye. Somewhere in the heart of a man, seems to me, there's a key, and it hides a fellow's yearning for the world he longs to see. And with just a simple turning, he can soon start making history. Somewhere in the heart of a man, there's a door, and what's more, he can fling it wide and throw the key away. And for me, it's like a sunrise on a summer day.
Well, I understand that this is the end of the first part of the show. I hope I'm not stealing the floor from our wonderful artists. I would like to extend my warmest thanks for this amazing, very provocative, very funny, very reflective, very inspirational concert. And I also would like to say sorry for this evil spirit that muddles up with our preparation and recording, but well, rest assured, you will have a chance to listen to William's concert again, just as we did with the first part of the show. I mean, last month, we will also upload the recording of the meeting, and you will have a chance to reflect on what you've heard at ease. I'm particularly grateful for the historical context that you have provided us with, because it makes it so easier, much easier for us to understand when the songs were created, for what reason. So thank you so much. And hopefully we'll also have a chance to hear William and take part in different events of the Hub next month. So we're not saying goodbye to him. And let me remind you that you will have a chance to say thank you personally to William in the breakout rooms at the end of our meeting. And now let me pass on the floor back to Elizabeth. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Marta. So this takes us on to now the second part of our programme, which is called The Power of Poetry, Changing the World by Writing About Truth and Beauty. Mary Lean, journalist from the UK, will interview writer and novelist Yara Zgheib from Lebanon and the USA. But we'll start the interview with a reading of one of Yara's short essays. The reader is actress Anna McLeod from the UK.
On the water. Sand and waves and little toes at play on a winter beach. Chasing, flirting, brushing, teasing, touching, feeling happy squeals. Everything flows and nothing stands still, said Heraclitus. He also said, time is a game played beautifully by children. Morning plays along, balmy like a Sunday, a holiday like the golden buttery sheen of a warm croissant, the flakes fragile, fragrant, a breeze fluttering away, poetry of impermanence. Take my hand. Take both if you want. The Atlantic is warm, like it knows to be gentle with a pair of two-year-olds. Wade a bit further. There, lie on your back. The water, my hands will carry you. Don't be frightened. Blue, crystalline, and bird! Yes, a cormorant! Large and dark and glistening, long hooked bill, long neck. It coasts, claiming the sky, every open bit above. Spotless expanse, and then the sun makes it all glitter, shimmer, bright white. We squint. Suddenly, where'd the bird go? It dove 50 meters deep into the ocean. Seconds later, it emerges, cocky, beak full, triumphant. Little panicked arms clutch my neck. It's okay, look. The bird stands on the shore, wings outstretched to dry, and warm its plumage. Applause! Children imitating cormorants are even more wonderful than cormorants. Kobayashi Isa wrote that 200 years ago. He must have known the two children I watch over now, on their backs, on my arms, on the water, trusting both, floating again. Or he was once a child himself, imitating cormorants, choosing to stay that way, say yes to life, become a poet, to live. Live all you can. Love. Woe to the man whose heart has not learned while young to hope, to love, and to put its trust in life. To put theirs into my arms, float on their backs, look up, flap imaginary wings into the waves. As the bird appears again, delights, disappears, shoots up, sprinkling sky. Sugar mist. Two-year-olds at play on a beach. No longer quite so warm. It is winter, and everything flows and nothing stands still. The light is always changing. The sea does not cease to grind down rock. Generations do not cease to be born, and we are responsible to them. So I ask, are you hungry? Yes, voraciously to life, to a second round of those light, airy, delicate croissants, stuffed, they hope, with chocolate. Yes, to splashing out of the water, all alone now, flapping, squeaking, delighted, imitating cormorants, I follow. Sand and waves in between toes, in hair, nostrils, snort, laugh, noses, lips pink, fingers that kiss to taste of sea water. The sea rises, the light fails, lovers cling to each other, and children cling to us, until one day, they no longer need me to float on water.
Thank you so much, Anna. Mike, can you put Yara on the screen? Hi. And if I can join her too, that would be great. But thank you, Anna. That was absolutely wonderful. I just love that. And I love what you say there.
That was magnificent.
I hoped you liked the way I did it. I hope I understood what you wanted to say, Yara. It's a lovely, lovely thing.
You transported me. It was magical hearing you read it.
I love what you said about choosing to stay like a child, choosing to say yes to life, to become a poet. And I think that's a choice you've made. And I'd like to talk more about that. But first, I should probably just introduce you to everyone. So just briefly to say that Yara was born in Lebanon and now lives in Boston. And she has a doctorate in international affairs and diplomacy and has worked as a consultant on peace and security strategies. She was one of the organizers of the Caux Forum on Just Governance for Human Security. But she now focuses on her writing and her two small twins who we have just heard about. She's a published novelist, and we have just heard one of the essays from her blog, The Non-Utilitarian. So it's such a joy and privilege to talk to you. And I'd just like to go back to that idea of choosing to become a poet, because what we've heard is prose, but of course it is poetry. And I'd like to know how you came to make that choice to give your time to your writing, to being a poet.
Well, first, thank you, Mary, for having me here. Thank you, all of you. And Anna, you are truly an artist. So wonderful hearing you. In response to your question, Mary, it was a very long and convoluted journey, which took me all the way to a doctorate in international relations and in working with the military. And I suppose I had a love and a desire. I've always loved writing. I've always loved reading. I was the child with my head in books. And there is just something incredible about the power of words and of poetry to reach across words and papers and time and space and move somebody. You can read words written by someone you've never met, will never meet, who has died hundreds, thousands of years ago. I mean, Kobayashi Issa from the haiku in that essay, he's long gone, but his words resonate true and radical and powerful with me today. And there's just something incredible about that. So I've always loved words and I've always wanted to be a writer, but of course that's not a real job. It's not a serious profession when you're Lebanese where I come from, you have to become a doctor or a lawyer or something, you know, serious, and that will change the world. And so I did want to change the world. I wanted to do something good. And so I studied international relations, and then I specialized in peace and security and counterterrorism. And to make a very long story short, I went all the way to a PhD and I worked in Washington, and I didn't like it. And it was a very jaded world. And I realized that was not the world I wanted. It was not the world I wanted to live in. It was not the world I believed. Circumstance led me back to writing, and I found that, you know, that there is something about poetry. There is something powerful and transformative in writing about beauty. And if I can write something that brings you joy, or that makes you feel understood, or feel less alone, is that not changing the world in some way? Mm. Sorry, that's a very long answer to your very short question.
No, that's wonderful. Because that whole thought, you have something on your website about sharing the beautiful things you just find laying around the world. And I've been reading some of your essays, and I love the way you take something like an apple tree in New York, and then you use it as a metaphor for the whole city. And there's sort of so much richness and so much poetry in what you write. And that idea of changing the world by writing about
beauty. Thank you for saying that, but really my internet's breaking up. Could you just say the last question, the last sentence you said again, please?
Sorry, it could be mine that's breaking up. That you have something, what yes, changing the world, just changing the world by writing about truth and beauty. I think that was what I was picking up on. And so often we think that, I suppose coming from a journalistic background, the journalistic view is that you change the world by writing about what's wrong, outraging people and getting them to work for change. But you also change the world by writing the stories of hope that actually empower people, that make people feel I can make a difference. And there isn't enough of that happening, I think.
I think so too. I once read somewhere about, it was a novel about a revolution. I believe it was about the French Resistance during the Second World War. And apparently they had instructed all the young people joining the Maquis to memorize a collection of poems because it would be useful if they were ever imprisoned. And I thought that image was, whether or not it's true that and whether or not it was useful to know a bunch of poems when you're a member of the resistance in your court, I think there is tremendous beauty, and we tend to mistake, I apologize for the noise if you can hear it, but we tend to mistake beauty for happiness, and I don't think the two are the same, you know, that by saying we choose to see beauty, there's a misconception that the world is la la land and butterflies and everybody's happy and jumping around, you know, running along the sea, chasing cormorants. And that's not true. That's not true. There, beauty is not just happiness. There's a lot of sadness. And seeing beauty does not mean shutting our eyes to the sadness and the suffering and the pain. It is a decision to see, to live with that pain, to accept it, to make something of it, you know, and I don't know if I'm expressing that thought correctly.
That leads me on to another question I wanted to ask, which is about your novels, because your first book, The Girls at 17 Swan Street, deals with a really tough subject. I've just got it from the bookshop. Here it is, everyone. Woo-hoo! Can you see it? So I'm really looking forward to reading it. But it deals with the subject of anorexia, which is a really tough subject. And so does, and your next book, No Land to Light On, is also about a tough subject. So it's, you're turning towards them as well, yeah, what you say about beauty not being in opposition to reality. And I don't know if you'd like to tell us a little bit about your second novel. I know you've got a passage to read to us from it, but perhaps you'd like to say something about why you wrote it and what it's about.
No Land to Light On.
Yes, yes.
No Land to Light On is a novel about a Syrian couple. They're a young couple called Sama and Hadi who live in Boston and in 2017 find themselves separated because of the travel ban enacted by the previous US administration. It's an executive order that shows six countries. It has been called the Muslim ban by the media, but according to that executive order, which was issued on a Friday, I believe, or a Thursday, effective immediately, all people coming from six countries, whether or not they had visas, whether or not they lived in the United States, were barred from entering the country, randomly, indefinitely, across the board. And this couple, Sama and Hedy, find themselves separated. Hedy had left the country for a brief while, leaving Sama pregnant in Boston, and returns on Saturday and is turned back at Logan Airport and sent to Amman, because when you're a Syrian refugee, you can't really be sent back to Syria. So sent back to Jordan, which is where he had flown from. And the novel is the story of their love. First of all, their fight trying to be reunited, trying to bring Hedy back to the United States, fighting that travel ban, and then also fighting themselves, fighting their passports, fighting their origins and really trying to find a way home and questioning what home is, what love is. And it's a love story. It is not about the travel ban. It is not about politics. It is not a story of right and wrong. And God knows I'm not the person to ask about right and wrong. I have no wisdom, no knowledge. But it is a love story. It is a story of love that flies above borders. That's higher, bigger than that.
And I think you said there is an autobiographical element in it. Is that fair to ask?
There is very much. I'm not Syrian, I'm not a refugee, and I was not affected by that executive order. What the autobiographical element is relates to a previous order that was enacted by the same administration that forced my husband and me to leave the country. He left when I had just given birth to our twins, and they were both in the they were both born premature. He left to renew his visa in Lebanon and was unable to return because of that executive order, which placed him in this horrible thick limbo of a term called administrative processing, which means we still don't know what that means, and there are people who are still in it. We know of an Italian professor at Harvard who is still unable to return to the US and has had to rewrite his life. To make a very long story short, my husband left for Lebanon supposedly for a few days to renew his visa and come back to the children and me, and was unable to return. And my visa became non-valid because I'm on a spouse visa, and we had to sell everything we own, leave the country, pack up two infant twins. I had to get on that plane, and my sister flew to Boston to fly the twins to Lebanon with me. We basically had to shut down our lives in the United States and go to Lebanon for a really long time. And we also had to question what home is and what matters. And is home your apartment? Is home your job? Is home... who are you if your passport says that you're a second-class citizen or a second-class human or less than a human? And who decides who a human is? Who decides where home is? Who drew these borders on this planet? And I could go on and on and on, but the conclusion of both the novel and my own personal story is that love is just so much stronger, and you decide what home is, and you decide who you are and what matters. And freedom is not something people can impose on you. Freedom is a choice.
Wow, wow. You are going to read us something from the novel. Would you be able to?
Yes, that was very difficult because there was so much I wanted to read, and I ended up highlighting the entire book, and then I don't know more.
We've got a lot of time.
Time for the entire book. Here is what I have. I'll just give you a brief historical timeline, just to give you some political context, and then I'll dive right into a scene in the middle of the book. So in 2011, for those of you who do not know, the pro-democracy protests erupt in Syria as part of the Arab Spring, demanding the end of the authoritarian practices of the Assad regime. The Syrian government uses violence to suppress these demonstrations, opposition militias form. By 2012, the Syrian uprising has escalated into a civil war. In 2015, the violence enters its fifth year. The number of Syrian refugees reaches 4.27 million, according to the UNHCR. Of those, the United States pledges to resettle 10,000 refugees within the year. And then we enter the story. Hadi is one of those 10,000 refugees who are resettled. And I will skip the part where they meet. Sama is a student living in Boston. He is a refugee who arrives. They meet, fall in love, skip. I hope you read the book and like it. I think their love story is a beautiful love story, but I'm biased because I'm in love with Sama and Hadi. We fast forward to January 27, 2017, which is when the administration issues Executive Order 13769, which says, the title is Protecting the Nation from Foreign Terrorist Entry into the United States, and begins with, by the authority vested in me as president, la-di-da-di-da. Executive Order 13769 temporarily bans all people from Iran, Iraq, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, and Yemen from entering the United States for at least 90 days. Admission for Syrian refugees is suspended indefinitely. Hadi is stopped at the border, sent back. Sana enters premature labor and gives birth to a young boy. He is in the intensive care unit, and the nurse in the ICU is asking her whether she's chosen a name for her son. And I'm going to start reading now. Nassim. I look at him, asleep in his purified world. Nassim is in an incubator. It means light breeze, I tell the nurse, and taste the name in its entirety. Nassim Deep. The syllables flow off my tongue, limpid, rustling through trees, rippling over seas and fields and sand dunes. Nassim. We had wanted a name as clear and vast as this country, his by birth, ours by choice, by wish, by need, by hope. A name he could breathe, but also one he could stand on, a heritage. A name that smelled of earth, the budding citrus of our father's orchards, the nutmeg of our mother's kitchens. A name that recalled the country you and I had come from. It's a lovely name, the nurse says. I'll bring you a birth certificate form. You will need the father's signature. Have you been able to reach him? In parentheses, I'm going to skip a few chapters. She has not been able to reach Hadi because Hadi is on a plane back to Amman. And Sama finally manages to get Hadi on the phone and tells him that she's given birth and that he has a son. So now we are, this is the conversation between Sama and Hadi. I have a son. You have a son. And just like that, we cross the planet. Somewhere over the Atlantic, we touch. In a moment, shorter than a plank, infinite, bursting with light. It swirls, shimmering, filling every atom of space, and nothing else matters. All of it dissolves. Passports and cancelled visas, planes and windowless rooms, interrogations, little bits of boarding passes, forms, executive orders, flimsy, vaporous documents. They blow away in shimmering particles. My God, Sama, I... Hebig. I forget the words in English too. Pebek. Pebig, you say again and again, like music notes beating to perfect cadence, certain coming home, like a heartbeat, like you are beating yours to mine. Pebek, I tell you, beating my own across the planet and time, over walls and oceans. I don't know where they touch, but they do. Describe him to me, you ask. I couldn't see him well in the incubator. It doesn't matter, Sama. You're right, it doesn't. Oh, I'm sorry. You're right, it doesn't. All right, then. We take off, the three of us. I describe lashes that curl like petals, a nose like yours, 10 fingers, almost impossibly fine, 10 toes. You ask for more, blind and starved. I describe almond eyes, the color of sky at noon in July. On cheeks, freckled constellations, a dimple, same size as mine. I describe the most beautiful baby in the world. I tell us a story. I stretch it like sky from Boston to Amman. We both leap for it, hanging on to the phone, to the words, as unconcerned with their truth as was gravity and the laws of men and nature. Reality and its ugly abysses and walls. I close my eyes and they cannot enter. Only light does. And in the space behind my eyelids, only the present. Dabs of whites, blues, infinite blues, powder pinks and pastel greens. I open my eyes and land us all safely. you, me, and Nassim. The birth certificate form is by the bed. It is pink. Will you fill out the birth certificate with me? Nothing on the phone. Then sound waves quiver in my ear. Fathers shouldn't cry. Rather, when they do, the spinning earth should stop. Come on, Herdy. Ballpoint pen. First question. Child's full name. Nassim Deeb. I wait for you to confirm. An exhale reaches me. It's perfect, you say. It's air, freedom. Our son's name is our dream. The greatest accomplishment of our lives. Nassim Deeb, American. Nassim Deeb, who will never be stopped at Customs and Border Protection. Mother's name, father's name, date and place of birth. Nassim, son of Stama and Herdy, born on the 28th of January in Boston, Massachusetts. Free to go wherever he wants, beyond all seas, all frontiers, all countries, all beliefs. Be whoever he wants to be, nothing and no one will see. In blue ink, I make the first indelible marks of the ink that will draw him. I can already see, just as in Delhi, that dazzling mosaic. Our son, the deep blue passport with a proud golden eagle, Nassim will have the life we came here for. I sign the form and date it. I hope that wasn't too long.
Oh, it was wonderful. That was my second lump in the throat moment of the afternoon. That was really wonderful. We need to end soon, but I'd just like to ask you, or at least talk a little bit about, you had this great idea that we would put one story for every year of Caux's 75 years up on the Caux website, of someone who came to Caux and what it did to them and what resulted from it. And you started it off for us by writing your own story of your Caux experience. And I just wondered if you'd like to say something about how you came to Caux and what that has meant in your life.
Well, I'll try to be very, very brief. First, you've taken this project, you and John and everybody who's made it such a wonderful creation. For anyone who doesn't know, 75 stories are being posted on the website, and it is a beautiful testament to just the magic of Caux. And there's a story by somebody for every year of the 75 years that Caux has been in operation. I cannot applaud you enough for what you've made of it. It is wonderful. So for all of you in attendance, if you have not read the stories, do go online and read them. They are marvelous. I came to Caux in 2011 as an intern, completely by mistake. And I had not heard of Caux, and I did not know what it was and what this philosophy was. And at the time, I was grieving a young brother I had lost. I was grieving a career that was already making me jaded and sad and angry at the world. And I was a very angry and sad person when I came to Caux. And I found this place where people believed in love and kindness and changing the world and in humans and in freedom of belief and freedom of thought and forgiveness. And it was just it was like a drug. I was hooked. I had to come back, and I came back the following year to help with organizing the conference on just governance and human security, and for all the years after that. And I knew I had to be a part of this group of people who were just so radically changing the world by looking inwards first and having the courage to change themselves and to accept difference as something that enriches you and responsibility for every other human being and every other living creature in the world. And Caux was just a magical place. I'm so fortunate to have come across it.
Thanks so much, Yara. This has been much too short. So I'd urge everyone to go to Yara's website, which you'll find in the chat, and read some of her amazing essays. You can sign up and then you get one once a week. And also it will give you links to where you can find her books. So I'm not sure if we're handing back to Marta or Elizabeth, but someone knows.
So. Yes, it is me. It is me to thank you both, ladies. It's been a delight to hear your dialogue. I always feel humble in front of, you know, literary people, and especially two literary people talking to each other. But thank you so much for making this possible. Thank you so much, Yara, for allowing us to live in the world of your novel and the world of your own experience, because it gives us such an important background to understand also what you write about. And it's been a delight. And again, I will want to repeat what I said after William's presentation. You will all have a chance to hear the conversation again, to reflect on all the important things. I'm so happy you stressed the importance for life, hope, optimism, beauty, in the face of all that we're now exposed to. So I'm sure I'm thanking on behalf of everybody. And I'm happy you have also referred to the stories, because that's what I wanted to highlight as well. So that's one thing, to send you back to the website with the stories written by Yara, written by Mary, written by a number of other people, making this possible for us to understand also the history behind us. But also, as you're thinking now, which breakout room to choose, which I'm sure it's very difficult, because both of our artists are extremely talented, inspirational, interesting people. Let me just take a moment to tell you what we're in for. Not now, but next month. Of course, you all know, but maybe it takes a moment to remind all of you that we will have a feast a month from now on the 1st of August, the Day of Gratitude. I'm going to paste the link now, and also Mike is going to share an image. What to expect? There'll be a number of things during the day, so please plan for the day so that you have enough space. We'll start with the fresco by Segestrale. You've heard about it, you know, it kind of inspired our leitmotif for the art meetings, the water, and it'll take a form of meditation. I'm sure it will be a very good way to start the hub days, and also to say goodbye to the Caux forum, which will end also on the same day. In the middle of the day, we'll have the kind of proper opening gala of the hub with the focus on the Day of Gratitude. And I'd like to remind you also on this little project that was inspired by Sveinung Nygaard, the artist whose music you heard at the beginning. He's asked us to create little paper boats, origami boats, and that's what I did yesterday, with our personal story, and to film us when floating those boats on some water. And if we send those pieces to Sveinung, he will turn it into a short video with music that he will create for this purpose. So if you want to be a part of some artistic events in that way, I think you still have a chance. The deadline is 11th of July. And the last thing I want to highlight is another feast. We will have a chance to hear again some Caux songs, but in a different arrangement. This time we'll have a chance to hear a choir that will be singing live from Caux, as it will also be the Swiss National Day. And it will be broadcast live for all of us. You will find the exact timings and links to register on the website. So this will come in a month, but this is not the end of artistic events. And let me now hand over back to Elizabeth. Thank you.
Thanks, Marta. This is just briefly to say about one other activity that's come our way from one of our friends who's involved in the arts network. And I'm going to ask Mike if he would just put the slide up. This is an invitation from Nick Dahlström in Sweden, who has working on a project he's called Ship of a New Story. And he would like to invite anybody who's got time to join him. It's next week. And I'm hoping that it will be big enough for you to see. And it's three short periods on the 6th and 7th of July, and he would like to invite anybody to join if he can. And I'm going to put Nick's contact details onto the chat, because that's the way to get to join that one. And then I'm going to say at this point in time, I think Marta may also be wanting to say this as well, but you will have realized, because we've had a few little glitches as we're going along with the Zoom, but we've had a terrific support from Mike Mwikia from Kenya and Khaled Solomon from Egypt as our technical team. But we've discovered through doing all of these activities how hard it is to do smooth presentations with lots of different inputs on Zoom. So we're really grateful to both of them for all their hard work to make this happen, to keep it going, even when there's a little interruptions around the world. But you know, when we're trying to join Egypt, Kenya, America, Poland and the UK, that's quite a challenge in itself. So now I'm going to hand back to Marta, who's going to talk about the breakout rooms.
My microphone. Thank you so much, Elizabeth. Now I think the most tricky point is coming, because I'm not sure how technically it's going to work. Now, let me just say that we have come to the end of the official part of the show. And of course, those of you who need to rush on to deal with your duties, you are obviously now free to do so. But we hope that you will stay with us and you will take the opportunity to get a chance to talk or to thank our two wonderful artists. And it will be done in the form of the breakout rooms. And now, if you look at your screen, you have, I can see now it's been open. I don't know whether this is what you see now on my screen. At the bottom of the screen, you have those boxes, like the four boxes. If you click on that, it should open and it should give you an opportunity. At the bottom, you have, when you scroll down after all the names of the participants who are with us now, you have the name William with in room number one and Yara, room number two. And next to these two names, you have the word join. So now we'll give you a moment, maybe with a bit of music if we manage to play it, to click on the join word, and then you will be transported to those breakout rooms. You will have about 10 minutes. And then after you finish your conversations, you will be free to go. So let me thank all the artists once again for wonderful presentations, all the people who've worked behind the scenes to make it ready. To our technical co-host, as you see, there's a lot of challenge involved. And to you, our audience, because without you, that wouldn't make sense, right, to work for it. So thank you so much. Enjoy the conversations and see you next month.